Yeah, of course I
am. Right. You'll know. You'll see. You'll hone in on it, I'm sure.
I think that's a sort of a wild blank, but
too. So I don't like that I do.
I mean, yeah, that sometimes makes me so upset. Like, damn, it's just so funny. I'm talking to you.
I told myself I didn't want a library anymore. The books called out to me. My books are my friends. My real friends. Always loyal, always kind. They love me no matter what I do. I was a different man when I returned to Milan after the island. I thought I no longer needed or desired books, but it seems some things never change. My hunger for magic had passed, but not my thirst for knowledge. Now that is as great as it ever was. The island changed me. I'm different in appearance. I speak a different language, but my mind is the same. It hasn't changed.
Benedite septentrione, ad meridiem, ad orientem et occidentem, veni tempestas!
Oh! allay them. Oh, I have suffered with those that I saw suffer. A brave vessel dashed all to pieces. The cry did knock against my very heart.
Be collected. No more amazement. Tell your piteous heart. There's no harm done.
Poor souls, they perish.
No harm. I have done nothing but in care of thee. Thee, my dear one, thee, my daughter, who art ignorant of what thou art, not knowing of whence I am, nor that I am more better than Prospero, master of a full poor cell, and thy no greater father.
The storm has frightened me, father.
Wipe thine eyes. Have comfort.
Wilt thou tell me a story, father, as thou used to do in my infancy?
There once was...
Father, there once was...
Yes, there once was a child, not 3 years old.
Did the child have three or four women that tended on her?
That she did. How dost thou know this?
I know not. Perhaps I saw it in a dream.
Her father was the Grand Duke of Milan and a prince of power. Her mother was a piece of virtue. The child was the Duke's only heir.
What happened to the child, father?
The Duke had a brother, uncle to the child, called Antonio. But mark me, how perfidious was he. The Duke loved him best in all the world, after his daughter, and put him to manage his estate, which was the first in all the signories.
What did he do?
The Duke had dignity without parallel, and the liberal arts for all his study. So wrapped in his studies was the Duke that he cast the government of the state upon his brother. The uncle of the child proved to be false, and the state grew stranger. Officers that were true to the Duke, he made his creatures.
Pray continue, father.
He advanced those that would help him, and set all hearts in the state to what tune pleased his ear. The Duke, neglecting worldly ends and dedicated to the bettering of his mind, did not realize the evil nature awakened in his false brother. His trust had no limits. His brother was so lorded with his revenue and power that, in actions, he was the Duke. Showing an outward face of royalty, his ambition grew.
What happened then, father?
What happened then was that my dear brother Antonio stole my dukedom. I was blinded by my books, ensconced in my learning. I wasn't paying attention. I was happy to leave the ruling to him. I didn't see his ambition. Over time, his ambition grew so great that through homage and annual tribute, he made a friend of the King of Naples. The King of Naples! Never did my beautiful Milan make such a dark alliance. The King of Naples accepted his tributes and offered in return to bestow my dukedom upon him, on one condition only, that Antonio should unburden himself of my daughter.
One midnight, Antonio and his men opened the gates of Milan, and in the dead of darkness, hurried thence the Duke and his crying daughter.
Why did they not destroy them?
They durst not. His people bore him great love, and Antonio wanted no bloody mark on the business. With colors fair, he painted his foul ends. His men hurried the Duke and his daughter aboard a bark, and bore them some leagues to sea, where they prepared a rotten carcass of a boat, not rigged, nor having tackle, sail, nor mast. There they hoist them to cry to the sea that roared, and sigh to the winds, and sighed back in pity.
Was the child troublesome to her father?
It was the child that did preserve him. She smiled, and it infused in him a fortitude from heaven, which raised in him the strength to bear against what should ensue. By Providence divine, a noble Neapolitan, Gonzalo, though master of the plan, out of his charity he did give them food, fresh water, garments, stuffs, necessaries. Knowing the Duke loved his books, he furnished him from his own library with volumes that the Duke prized above his own dukedom.
If I should meet gentle Gonzalo, I should thank him.
The Duke and his daughter arrived on an island, There he became schoolmaster to the child and made her more profit than any other tutor.
Did the child ever see her uncle again, father?
Bountiful fortune did the Duke's enemies bring to that shore.
Father, thou didst not tell the child's name.
Her name was Miranda.
How?
Here cease more questions. Thou art inclined to sleep. I know thou canst not choose. Ariel, approach. Ariel, my servant, come. Hast thou, spirits, performed to point the tempest that I bade thee?
To every article I boarded the king's ship, now on the beak, now in the waist, the deck, in every cabin I flayed amazement. Sometimes I divide and burn in many places. On the topmast, the yards, and bowsprit, would I flame distinctly the meat and join? The fire and cracks of sulphurous roaring, the most mighty Neptune seem to besiege and make his bold waves tremble, his dread trident shake. All plunged in the foaming brine and quit the vessel, then all afire with me. The king's son, Ferdinand, was the first man that leaped, cried, "Hand is empty, all the devils are here." Close by and safe. Not a hair perished on the garments, not a blemish but fresher than before. And as thou bade me, in troops I have dispersed them about the isle. The king's son have I landed by himself, and left sighing in an odd angle of the isle.
Ariel, thy charge exactly is before, but there is more work before thy time be out.
Oh, toil, since thou dost give me pains, let me remember thee what thou hast promised, which is not yet performed me, my liberty. I have done thee worthy service, told thee no lies, made no mistakings, and served without grudge. Thou didst promise to bid me a full year.
Hast thou forgot the foul witch Sycorax? Hast thou forgot her? Thou hast. Where was she born? Speak. Tell me. This damned witch Sycorax, for mischiefs manifold and sorceries terrible from Argier, was banished, but for one reason they did not take her life. This black-eyed hag was hither brought with child, and was here left by the sailors. Thou, my slave, was then her servant, and for thou wast a spirit too delicate to act her abhorred commands. Refusing her grand hest, she did confine thee into a cloven pine, within which rift and prison thou didst painfully remain a dozen years, within which space she died, and left thee there to vent thy groans. Then was this island not honored for the human shape, save for that son that she did litter here, a hag-born whelp. He, that Caliban, whom now I keep in service. Thou best knowest what torment I did find thee in. Thy groans did make wolves howl. It was mine art, when I arrived and heard thee, that made me gape the pine and let thee out. If thou more murmurest, I will rend an oak, and peg thee in as knotty entrails till thou hast held away 12 winters, if thou wilt do this gently. And as I command, in 2 days I will discharge thee. Go, make like an imp of the sea, invisible to every eyeball else but mine. Go take the shape and lead Ferdinand, the king's son, to this place. Hence, with diligence, please. Awake, my heart. Let's visit Caliban, my slave who never yields us kind answer.
'Tis a villain I do not love to look on.
But we cannot miss him. He does make our fire, fetch in our wood, and serves in offices that profit us. What ho, slave! Caliban!
That's what it up within!
Come forth, I say, there's other business for thee. Thou poisonous slave got by the devil himself upon thy wicked dam. Come forth!
The southwest blow on ye, and blister you all over.
For this, be sure, tonight thou shalt have cramps.
This island is mine! By Sycorax, my mother, which thou takest from me. When thou camest first, They'll focus me. They'll make as much of me. We'll give me water with berries in it. And teach me how to name the bigger light. And how the less that burn by day and night. And then I love thee. And show thee all of the qualities of the isle. The fresh springs. The brine pits. Barren places and fertile. Curse be I that did so. All the charms of cigarettes, toads, beetles, bats, light on you. Right? And all the subjects that you have, which first was mine own king. And here you stymie me in this hard rock, while you do keep me from the rest of the island.
Thou lying slave, I have used thee, filth, as thou art, with human care, and lodged thee in mine own cell to thou didst seek to violate the honor of my child.
Would had it then been done, thou didst prevent me. I did people else this island with Caliban.
A horrid slave! I pity thee. Took pains to make thee speak, taught thee each hour one thing or other when thou didst not, savage, know thine own meaning, but wouldst gabble like a thing most brutish. I endowed thy purposes with words that made them known. But thy vile race had that in it which good natures could not abide to be with. Therefore wast thou confined into this rock, who has deserved more than a prison.
You taught me language. My profit on it is, I know how to curse. A red plague rid you for learning me your language.
Hack seed heads. Fetch us some fuel and be quick. Trust thou malice. If thou neglect'st or dost unwillingly what I command, I will fill all thy bones with aches. Make thee roar, that beast shall tremble at thy din.
No, obey thee. I must obey. Art is of such power, it would control my damned god Setimus and make a vassal of him.
So, slave, hence.
Where should this music be? In the air or the earth? Sitting on a bank, weeping the king my father's wreck. This music crept by me upon the waters, allaying both their fury and my passion in its sweet air. Thence I followed it, or it hath drawn me.
O Father, find thy father lies, off his bones are coronated, those are pearls that were his eyes, nothing of him that doth fade. But that suffer as he change into something rich and strange. Seemings are hearing his bell. Hark, I hear them ding-dong bell.
The dizzy does remember my drowned father. This is no mortal business.
Father, what is it? A spirit?
No, it eats and sleeps and hath such senses as we have. This gallant which thou seest was in the wreck. Thou mightst call him a goodly person. He has lost his fellows and strays about to find them.
He is a thing divine, for nothing natural I ever saw so noble.
Spirit, fine spirit, in 2 days I shall free thee for this.
Most sure the goddess of whom these airs attend. May you some good instructions give how I may bear me here. Oh, you wonder. If you be maid or no?
No wonder, sir, but certainly a maid.
My language, heavens, I am the best of them to speak this speech where I but were to spoken.
How the best? What wouldst thou if the King of Naples heard thee?
A thing what wonders to hear thee speak of Naples. I, myself, am Naples, who with mine eyes beheld the king my father's wreck, and all his lords, the Duke of Milan and his brave son being twain.
The Duke of Milan and his more braver daughter could control thee if now to fit to do it. At first sight, they have changed eyes. Ariel, I shall be free for this. Sir, I fear you have done yourself some wrong. A word.
Why speaks my father so ungently? This is the third man that e'er I saw! The first that e'er I sighed for! Pity move my father to be inclined
Naples.
They are both in either's powers, but this swift business I must uneasy make. Yet, too light winning make the prize light. One word more. I charge thee that thou attend me. Thou here dost usurp the name thou owest not, and hast put thyself upon this island as a spy to win it from me, the Lord on it.
No, as I am a man.
Come, follow me. Speak not you for him, he's a traitor. Come, I'll manacle thy neck and feet together. Follow.
No, I will resist such entertainment till my enemy has more power.
Sir, make not too rash a trial of him, for he's gentle and not fearful.
Put thy sword up, traitor, who makes a show but dares not strike thy conscience so possessed with guilt. I can here disarm thee with this stick and make thy weapon drop.
Sir, have pity. I'll be his surety.
Silence. An advocate for an impostor? Hush. Think'st thou there are no more such shapes as he, having seen but him and Caliban?
My affections are then most humble. I have no ambition to see a goodlier man.
My spirits, as in a dream, are all bound up. My father's loss, this weakness which I feel, the wreck of my friend, nor this man's threats are all but light to me. Might I but through my prison once a day behold this maid.
It works. Follow.
Be of comfort. My father is of a better nature, sir, than he appears by speech. This is most unwonted, which now came from him.
Ariel, I shall be as free as mountain winds, but then exactly to all points of my commands. Follow me. Speak not for him.
Beseech you, sir, be merry. You have cause, so have we all of joy. For our escape is much beyond our loss. Our hint of woe is common. Every day some sailor's wife has our theme of woe. But for the miracle, I mean our preservation, few in millions can speak like us. Then wisely, sir, weigh our sorrow with our comfort.
Prithee, peace.
Well, I have done. But yet though this island seems to be desert, uninhabitable, almost inaccessible, here the air breathes upon us most sweetly. Here is everything advantageous to life.
True, save means to live.
Of that there's none, or little.
How lush and lusty the grass looks, how green.
The ground indeed is tawny.
With an eye of green in it.
But the rarity of it is, which is indeed almost beyond credit, that our garments, being as they were drenched in the sea, hold notwithstanding their freshness and their gloss, being rather new dyed than stained with salt water, they are now as fresh as when we first put them on in Afric at the marriage of the king's fair daughter Claribel to the king of Tunis.
Tunis was never graced with such a paragon as their queen.
Sir, we were talking that our garments are now as fresh as when we first put them on in Afric at the marriage of your daughter who is now queen.
And the rarest that e'er came there. You crammed these words into mine ears against the stomach of my sense. Would I had not married my daughter, therefore, coming thence, my son is lost. And she too, in my rage, who is so far from Italy removed, I ne'er again shall see her. Mine heir of Naples and Milan, what strange fish hath made his meal on thee?
Sir, he may live. I saw him beat the surges under him and ride upon their backs, his bold head high above the contentious waves he kept, as he oared himself with his good arms and lusty stroke to the shore. I have no doubt that he came alive to land.
No. He's gone.
Sir! You may thank yourself for this great loss. You will not bless our Europe with your daughter, but rather lose her to a foreigner.
Prithee, peace!
You were kneeled to by all of us, and the fair soul herself weighed between loathness and obedience. Now we have lost your son. I fear forever Milan and Naples have more widows in them of this business's making than we bring men to comfort them. The fault's your own.
So is the dearest of the lost.
My lord Sebastian, the truth you speak doth lack the time and gentleness to speak it in. You rub the sore when you should bring the plaster.
Very well!
And most chirurgically.
It is foul weather in us all, good sir, when you are cloudy.
Foul weather!
Very foul.
Had a plantation of this isle, my lord, and were king on it. What would I do?
Escape being drunk for want of wine.
In the Commonwealth, I would by contraries execute all things. For no kind of traffic would I admit, no name of magistrate. Letters should not be known. Riches, poverty, and use of service, none. Contract, succession born, bound of land, tilth, vineyard, none. No use of metal, corn, or wine, or oil. No occupation. All men idle, all, and women too, but innocent and pure. No sovereignty.
Yet he would be king on it.
The latter end of his commonwealth forgets the beginning.
All things in common nature should produce. Without sweat or endeavor, treason, felony, sword, knife, pike, gun, or need of any engine, would I not have, but nature should of its own kind bring forth all poison, all abundance, and feed my innocent people.
No marrying among his subjects.
None, man. All idle. Whores and knaves.
I would with such perfection govern. Sir, to excel the golden age.
God save his majesty.
Long live Gonzalo.
Do you mock me, sir?
Prithee no more. Thou dost talk nothing to me.
No, but will you laugh me asleep, for I am very heavy.
Go sleep. My eyes are wondrous heavy. We too, my lord, will watch your person while you take your rest and guard your safety.
What a strange drowsiness possesses me.
It is the quality of the climate.
Why doth it not then our eyelids sink? I find not myself disposed to sleep.
Nor I. My spirits are nimble. What might, worthy Sebastian? Oh, what might? No more. And yet, I think I see it in thy face, what thou shouldst be. The occasion speaks thee, and my strong imagination sees a crown dropping onto thy head.
What, art thou waking?
Do you not hear me speak?
I do. Surely thou speaks out of thy sleep. What is it thou didst say? Well, this is a strange repose to be. Asleep, with eyes wide open, standing, speaking, and moving, yet so fast asleep.
Noble Sebastian, thou lets thy fortune sleep. Die, rather. Winks while thou art waking.
Thou dost snore distinctly. There's meaning in thy snores.
I am more serious than my custom. You should be too if heed me, which to do troubles the oar.
Well, I am standing water.
I'll teach you how to flow.
Do so. My hereditary sloth instructs me to ebb.
If only you knew how you the purpose cherish while you thus mock it. How in stripping it you more invest it. Ebbing men most often do so near the bottom run by their own fear or sloth.
Prithee, say on. The setting of thine eye and cheek proclaim a matter from thee.
Although this lord of weak remembrance hath here almost persuaded the king his son's alive, 'tis as impossible that he's undrowned as he that sleeps here swims.
I have no hope that he's undrowned.
Well, out of that no hope, what great hope have you? No hope that way is another way, so high a hope. Will you grant with me that Ferdinand is drowned?
He's gone.
Then who is the next heir of Naples?
Claribel.
She that is queen of Tunis. She that dwells 10 leagues beyond a man's life. She that of Naples can have no note, lest the sun were post, the man in the moon's too slow. She from whom we were all sea-swallowed, and some cast again, and by that act to perform a destiny whereof what's past is prologue, what's to come in yours and my discharge.
What stuff is this? How say you? 'Tis true my brother's daughter's queen of Tunis, so is she heir of Naples. Twixt which regions there is some space.
A space that seems to cry, how shall Claribel measure us back to Naples? Keep in Tunis and let Sebastian wake. If this were death that had now seized them, they would be no worse off than they are now. There be that can rule Naples as well as he that sleeps. Lords that can prate as amply and unnecessarily as this Gonzalo. Oh, that you bore the mind that I do. What a sleep were this for your advancement. Do you understand me?
I think I do.
And how does your content tend to your own good fortune?
I do remember you did supplant your brother, Prospero.
True, and look how well my garments sit upon me. My brother's servants were then my fellows, and now they are my men.
But for your conscience?
Aye, sir, where lies that? I feel not this deity in my bosom. 20 consciences that stand twixt me and Milan. Candied be they and melt ere they molest. Here lies your brother, no better than the ground he lies upon. If he were that which he is now like, that's dead, whom I, with this obedient steel, can lay to bed forever, put to the perpetual wake, for I he shall not obstruct our course.
Thy case, dear friend, shall be my precedent. As thou gott'st Milan, I'll come by Naples. Draw thy sword. One stroke shall free thee from the tribute which thou payest, and I, King Sebastian of Naples, shall love thee.
Draw together, and when I rear my hand, do you the like to fall it on Gonzalo.
Oh, but one word.
My master, through his art, foresees the danger that you, his friend, are in. If of life you keep a care, shake off slumber and beware. Awake!
Now, good angels, preserve the king!
What? Oh no, ho, awake! Why are you drawn? Wherefore this ghastly looking?
What's the matter?
Whilst we stood here, securing your repose, even now, we heard a hollow burst of bellowing, like bulls, or rather, lions. Did it not wake you? It struck mine ear most terribly.
I heard nothing. Oh, it was a din to fright a monster's ear, to make an earthquake. Surely it was the roar of a whole herd of lions. Heard you this, Gonzalo?
Upon mine honor, sir, there was a humming, and that a strange one too, which did awake me. As mine eyes opened, I saw the weapons drawn. There was a noise, that verily. 'Tis best we stand upon our guard, or else we quit this place.
Lead off this ground. Let us continue the search for my poor son.
Let us keep him from this beast, for surely he is in the island.
Lead away.
Here shall I die ashore. singing a man's funeral. Well, here's my comfort. The master, the swabber, the boatswain and I, the gunner and his mate, loved moment, Marianne and Marjorie. But none of us cared for Tate. She had a tongue.
You must torment me.
What's the matter? Have we devils here? I have not escaped drowning to be afraid of your four legs.
Don't let me, I pretty.
This is some four-legged monster of the isle who had got, as I take it, and ate you. How the devil did he learn our language? I will give him some relief. If I can recover him and keep him tame and get to Naples with him, he's a fit present for any king.
Oh, spirits, do not torment me. I'll bring my wood home faster.
He's a fit now and does not talk after the wisest. He shall taste my bottle. If he has never drunk wine before, it might remove his fit.
Oh, Don't be a little bird. I know it by thy trembling. Now Prospero works upon thee.
Oh, come on your ways. Open your mouth. Here is that which will give language to you. Open your mouth. This will shake your shaking. You cannot tell who's your friend. Open your chats again.
I should know that voice. It should be.
Oh, we are your these are devils. Oh, defend me.
Four legs and two voices. A most delicate monster. His front voice is to speak well of his friend, and his back voice is to utter foul speeches and to detract. My bottle will help his ache. Come. Amen, I will pour some in thy other mouth.
Stefano?
Does my other mouth call?
Oh, Stefano!
Mercy, mercy, this is a devil and no monster.
If thou be Stefano, touch me and speak to me, for I am Trinculo. Be not afraid, my good friend Trinculo!
If thou beest Trinculo, show thyself. Well, I will pull thee by the lesser legs.
If any be Trinculo's legs, these are they.
Thou art very Trinculo indeed. Oh, how camest thou to be the siege of this mooncalf? Trinculo's?
I took him to be killed with a thunderstroke. But art thou not living, Stefano? I hope thou art not drowned. Is the storm blown over? I hit thee with the dead mooncalf in fear of the storm.
Art thou living, Stefano?
Do not turn me about, for my stomach is not constant.
Brave things, if they be not sprites, let the brave god and bear celestial liquor. I will kneel to him.
How didst thou escape? How camest thou hither? Here, swear how thou escaped this. I escaped upon a barrel of wine which the sailors heaved overboard. Here, swear by this bottle. Which I made by the bark of a tree with mine own hand since I was cast ashore.
I'll swear upon that bottle to be thy true subject, for the liquor is not earthly.
Here, swear how thou escaped this.
Swam ashore, man, like a duck. I can swim like a duck!
Though thou canst swim like a duck, thou art made like a goose. How now, mooncalf? How doth thine age?
Hast thou dropped from heaven?
Out of the moon, I do assure thee. I was the man in the moon once upon a time.
I have seen thee in her, and I adore thee. My mistress has showed me thee, and thy dog, and thy bush.
The man in the moon?
Poor, credulous monster!
I'll show thee every frontal inch of the island, and I'll kiss thy foot. I prithee, be my god.
Why this lie of us all? Phineas and drunken mortal, and his gods asleep, and wrong as both.
I'll kiss thy foot. I swear myself thy subject.
What Come on then, down and swear.
Thank you. The island. I remember the island. What has happened to me? Am I still Sycorax? Yes. I am still Sycorax. Queen of the island and mistress of the spirits. Spirits. It was the spirits who put me to sleep. But it could not have been all of them, for I imprisoned their leader in a tree. Gone! Where has Ariel gone? She could not have escaped on her own. Her magic was not so great. There is some force at work here. Some magic force. Greater than the spirit's magic. Who is on my island? I remember a baby. A son. He was strong like his father. Where is my son? The island feels strange. I feel strange. I am Sycorax, queen of the island, yet I cannot feel all of my power. What has happened to my power? I sense someone has usurped me. How much time has passed? How much time has passed for Sycorax? Who is on my island? Who has taken my son?
This mean task would be as heavy to me as odious. But the mistress which I serve quickens what's dead and makes my labor's pleasures. She is 10 times more gentle than her father is bad-tempered, and he's composed of harshness. I must remove some thousands of these dogs and call them at his strict command. My sweet mistress weeps when she sees me works and says such baseness I've never like executor. These sweet thoughts refresh my labors.
Pray you, work not so hard. Pray set it down and rest you, my father's hard at study. So rest yourself, we're safe. 3 hours.
Oh, most dear mistress, the sun will set before I shall discharge what I must strive to do.
Well, if you'll sit down, I'll bear your logs a while. Pray, give me that. I'll carry it to the pile.
No, precious creature, I'd rather crack my sinews and break my back than should you such as honor undergo while I sit lazy by.
It should become me as well as it does you, and I should do it with far more ease, for my goodwill is to it and yours it is against.
Poor worm. Thou art infected, this visitation shows it.
You look wearily.
No, noble mistress. 'Tis fresh morning with me when you are by at night. I do beseech you. What is your name?
Miranda. Oh, my father, I have broke your hest to say so.
Admired Miranda, and be the top of admiration worth what's dearest to the world. Full many a lady I vied with best regard, but some defect in her quarreled with the noblest grace she owed. But you, oh, you so perfect and so peerless, are created of every creature's best.
I do not know one of my sex. No woman's face remember, save from my glass, mine own. Nor have I seen more that I may call men than you, good friend, and my dear father. How features are abroad, I am skillless of, but by my modesty, the jewel of my dower, I would not wish any companion in the world but you, nor can imagination form a shape besides yourself to like of. But I prattle too wildly, and my father's precepts I therein do forget.
I am in my condition a prince, Miranda. I do think a king. I would wear it not so, and would not endure this wooden slavery. Hear my soul speak. The very instant I saw you, did my heart fly to your services and dare reside, and make me slave to it. For your sake, I am this patient logman.
Do you love me?
I, beyond all limit of what else in the world, do love, prize, and honor you.
ravens rain grace on that which breeds between them.
Wherefore weep you?
My unworthiness that dare not offer what I desire to give, much less take what I should die to want. The more it seeks to hide itself, the bigger bulk it shows. Hence, bashful cunning, prompt me, plain and holy innocence. I am your wife, if you will marry me. If not, I'll die your maid. To be your mate, you may deny me, but I'll be your servant, whether you will it or no.
My mistress dares, and I as humble ever.
My husband, then?
Aye, with a heart as willing as bondage out of freedom, here's my hand.
And mine, with my heart in it. And now farewell, till half an hour hence.
And a thousand goodbyes!
So glad of this as they, I cannot be, who are surprised withal, but I'm rejoicing and nothing can be more. I'll chew my book, but yet ere supper time I must perform much business appertaining.
Servant monster, drink to me.
Oh, servant monster, the folly of this island.
Now they say there's but five upon this island. We have three of them.
The other two be brain like us, the state doctors.
Drink, servant monster, when I bid thee.
My eye. Are almost set in thy head!
Oh, well, how should they be set? You'd be a strange monster indeed if they were set in his tail!
My man monster hath drowned his tongue in wine. For my part, the sea cannot drown me. I swam to the shore 35 leagues. Off and on. Mooncalf, speak for once in thy life if thou beest a good Mooncalf.
I'm afraid. I heard a noise. Caliban has never heard that noise before.
Distant thunder, Mooncalf, nothing more. Now speak!
Caliban, that is my son? That is the child I spat blood to birth?
How does thy honor? Let me lick thy shoe. I'll not serve him. He's not valiant.
Thou liest, most ignorant monster! What a debauched fish thou! Was ever a man of Caliban have drunk as much wine as I today? Half a fish and half a monster.
Know how he mocks me, my lord! Will thou let him?
Did you know? Keep a good tongue in thy head. If you prove a mutineer, you'll hang on the next tree. This poor monster's my subject, and he shall not suffer indignity.
I thank my noble lord. Ooh, would thou be pleased to hearken to my suit?
Well, I will kneel and repeat it. I will stand. And so shall treat you.
It must be Caliban.
As I told thee, before I am subject to a tyrant, a sorcerer, that by his cunning hath cheated me of the island.
I see he has forgotten about his mother. Who is this tyrant he speaks of?
The island is mine!
Thou liest!
Thou liest, thou jesting monkey! I would my valiant master would destroy thee! I do not lie!
Treat you? Trouble this monster any more, and by this hand I'll supplant some of your teeth.
Why, I say nothing.
Mum, then. Proceed.
I say, my sorcery, he got this isle, from me he got it. If thy greatness will, revenge it on him, for I know thou darest. But this thing dare not.
That's no sin.
Thou shalt be lord of the island, and I'll serve thee!
And how shall this be accomplished? Canst thou bring me to the party?
Oh, yes, my lord. I'll yield thee a sleep. There, thou mayst knock a nail into his head.
Thou liest, thou canst not!
What a binding is this? I do beseech thy greatness. Give him blows, and take his bottle from him.
Drink now, and drop this monster one word further, and by this hand I'll supplant some of your teeth.
Did thou not say that he lied?
Thou liest!
Do I so? Take thou that. If you like this, give me the lie another time.
I did not give the lie! Any of which will get killed here! Pops on your bottle and murder on your monster with this devil take your king!
Now forward with your tail.
Prithee, stand farther off.
Beat him enough. After a little time, I'll beat him too.
My son is an imbecile, like his father. There is Ariel, as arrogant and insufferable a sprite as there ever was.
Stand farther. Proceed.
As I say, discuss them with Prospero in the afternoon to sleep. There, thou mayst brain him, or with the log, batter his skull. Remember to seize his books first, for without his books, he's as much a fool as I am. And he's got not one spirit to command, for they all hate him as deeply as I. Burn his books!
Prospero? I have never heard that name. Caliban says he commands the spirits with his books. He's the sorcerer who stole the island from me. The books must hold great power if burning them takes away all his magic. That's the source! That's the source of magic I sensed on the island when I awoke. The books belong to Prospero, yet I have somehow drawn part of their magic to myself. But my powers are still weak, and I sense the books have much, much more. If Sycorax is to become mighty again, I must have those books!
That most deeply to consider is the beauty of his daughter. He himself calls her Nonpareil. I never saw a woman but only Sycorax, my dam, and she far surpasses Sycorax!
Surpasses Sycorax? How easily this imbecile betrays me! Miranda the admired! The wizard Prospero's spawn is but a weed in Sycorax's garden. I shall pluck that weed out and destroy it. Better still, I shall marry it to my son.
Is it so brave, alas?
Aye, my lord! She will become thy bed, I warrant, and bring thee forth a brave brood.
Monster, I will kill this man. His daughter and I shall be king and queen, save our graces. And Trinculo and thyself shall be viceroys. Dost thou like the plot, Trinculo?
Excellent.
Give me thy hand. I am sorry I beat thee, but while thou livest, keep a good tongue in thy head.
Within this half hour will he be asleep. Wilt thou destroy him then?
Aye, on mine honor.
Thou makest me merry. I am full of pleasure. Let's be jocund.
At thy request, monster, I will. Come on, Trinculo, let us sing.
Sweet airs that give delight and hurt not. Sometimes a thousand twangling instruments hum about my ears. And sometimes voices, yet if I then had waked after long sleep, would make me sleep again. And then in dreaming, the clouds, we thought, would open up and show riches ready to drop upon me, that when I wake, I cry to dream again.
They shall prove the grave kingdom to me, or I shall have my music for nothing.
When Prospero is destroyed!
Oh, that'll be by and by. I remember the story.
When the sun is leaving, let's follow it and act as you are wise.
Treated you badly?
No, Mother. They've not treated me badly. They've not treated me well either. They just let me be.
They have let you grow in the wilderness of the island. Yet you speak. Who taught you to speak?
Oh, Prospero taught me language. He takes care of me.
Fool! Prospero has made a slave of you! You must not trust him anymore!
I don't know you, I'm afraid! Will you beat me?
If you don't stop being a fool, I will beat you soundly! I have not properly tested my magic since I awoke. I must wait till nightfall to test it on the moon. Before your birth, my magic could make the moon move. Now what of yours, son Caliban?
My what, Mother?
Your magic, imbecile? What powers do you possess?
Who? I know all the sounds of the island, and I can tell when something is by its footsteps. I know when my master is angry.
Then you disappoint me, Caliban. You have grown with no magic, or if you were born with any, you have forgotten how to use it. I see you have much work to do.
Work? Oh. My master will beat me if I don't finish my work!
And I will beat you if you don't start your work! Now stop bleating like a baby and do what I tell you! We must find the books.
Books? Books? Master! Mother! Books! Books! Master! Master! Mother! No!
I will follow. And when the books are found, I will take them before they can be destroyed.
Thank you.
I can go no further, sir. My old bones ache. Here's a mace trodden deep through meanders. By your patience, I must rest. I heard the thunder. There's a storm coming.
I cannot blame thee, O Lord. I too am attached with weariness to the dulling of my spirits. Sit down and rest. Even here, I'll put off my hope. He is drowned, whom we strayed to find. The sea mocks our hopeless search on land.
I am right glad that he is still out of hope. Do not for one moment forget the purpose you have resolved to effect.
The next advantage will we take thoroughly.
Then let it be tonight, for they are oppressed with travel and cannot be as vigilant as when they are fresh.
I say tonight, no more.
I did not imagine, could not have predicted the effect the island would have on those whom I brought to land here. I had planned to take my revenge on my brother Antonio and Alonso, the King of Naples, but it was as if somehow the island were working against me. Everyone wanted the island for themselves, and in their minds made it whatever they longed for. Gonzalo, my old servant and friend, imagined that he could be king of a fruitful and serene utopia. My brother Antonio and Sebastian, King Alonso's brother, imagined a shared kingdom with Sebastian at the helm. And they would have killed Alonso and Gonzalo to achieve it. By saving my old friend Gonzalo, Ariel did me a great favor. Oh, let's not forget the jester Trinculo and his drunken friend Alonso's butler Stefano. They imagined Stefano as king of the island with my Miranda in his bed. Neither would have thought of such a plan on his own. It was Caliban who laid it before them. I did not think of the witch Sycorax, who was queen of the island when I arrived there, and who I believed had died. Leaving her newly born son Caliban in its care and as its master. When I arrived there, I claimed the island as my own personal kingdom and tamed its spirits and enslaved them to my will. The spirits of the island remembered the time when there was no one here but them, and only they had free reign and sovereignty. I was angry with those who plotted to kill me. I was angry with them all. I wanted to see the pain and remorse on their faces as I made them pay. But first, I had to lure them into my trap.
Marvelous sweet music. Naples, I should report this now, that I saw such strange islanders. Would they believe me? For certes, they must be people of the island.
Such shapes, such gestures, and such sounds express an excellent kind of dumb discourse.
Praise and departing.
They vanish strangely.
No matter, since they have left their viands behind, for we have summits. Will it please you taste of what is here?
Not I.
Faith, sir, you need not fear. When we were boys, who would believe there were such men whose heads stood in their breasts? Which now, travelers report, truly exist.
I will stand to and feed, though it is my last, no matter. Since I feel the best is past, my brother, my lord duke, stand to and do as we.
Mm-hmm.
the liver servitude seed hath caused to belch you. And on this island where men do not inhabit, you, marksmen, are most unfit to live. I will make your minds mad, so that you will hand and drown your drowns.
Performed, my Ariel. A grace it had. And of my instruction hast thou nothing bated of what thou hast to say. My high charms work. And these, mine enemies, are all knit up in their distractions and are now in my power. And in these fits I leave them, while I visit young Ferdinand, whom they suppose is drowned, and his and my loved darling.
Sir, why stand you in the strange stare?
Oh, it is monstrous. Monstrous. But the clouds spoke and told me of it, the wind sang it to me, and the thunder pronounced the name Prospero. Proclaimed the baseness of mine actions, therefore my son lies in the ocean. We will seek him and with him my money.
I'll fight these devils one fiend at a time!
I'll be thy second!
The three of them are desperate. Their great guilt like poison gnaws at them. I must hinder them from what this madness may provoke them to.
Thank you.
on itself.
Monster! You little fairy! Would you say in the harmless fairy has made buffoons of us?
Monster! I smell fishy! At which my nose is in great indignation!
So is mine! Do you hear, monster? I should take a displeasure against you.
Thou art a lost monster!
Pray you, my lord, give me your favor still. Patience, for the prize I bring thee to shall hoodwink this mischance.
Why, but to lose your bottle in the fire!
There is not only disgrace in that, but infinite loss!
Prithee, my king, quiet! This is the mouth of the snail. No noise. Enter. Do that mischief that shall make this island thine own forever. And I, thy Caliban, forever thy footlicker.
I do begin to have bloody thoughts.
Stefano. Oh, worthy Stefano.
Look.
What a wardrobe is here for thee.
Let it alone, the fool, it is but trash!
Oh, monster, we no trash! This is not... Oh, King Stefano!
Take off that cloak, Trinculo! By this hand, I'll have that!
Oh, drop me, drown this fool! Let the trash alone and do the murder first! If he awakes first, he'll turn us into strange stuff and fill our skin with pinches! Come! Come, we've wasted time! We'll turn us into barnacles or apes if we do not do the deed!
Monster, help to bear this away, then retrieve our bottle from the swamp, or else I'll turn you out of my kingdom.
Oh, your majesty! Good monster!
Oh, worthy king!
Give me the cloak, fool!
Who are you to take away our things? Say your name!
I am Sycorax, queen of this island. Everything here, as far as you can see, belongs to me.
Well, look, King Stefano, we've got competition. Queen, eh?
Says who?
Look, the monster's scared. They're going to be scared. I'm just not scarecrow.
Queen of the scarecrow.
This island is full of idiots. No one speaks to cigarettes with such disrespect. For your impudence, you will die. And so will your drunken friend. Not you, imbeciles! Atiluka! Die, you creatures! Why will they not die? My magic is waning!
You too, my beauties! So hop!
Prideful and
was only later that I became humble.
Now does my project gather to a head. My charms crack not, my spirits obey, and time goes upright with this carriage. How's the day? How fares the king and his followers?
The day is on the sixth hour, at which time, my lord, you said our work should cease. They are all prisoners, sir, in the grove that weatherfends your cell. They cannot budge till your release. The king, his brother, and yours abide distracted, brimful of sorrow and dismay. The good old Lord Gonzalo, his tears run down his beard. Your charm so strongly works on them that if you now beheld them, your affections would become tender. Mine would, sir, were I human.
And mine shall. Though with their high wrongs I am struck to the quick, yet with my noble reason gainst my fury do I take part. The rarer action is in virtue than in vengeance. As they are penitent, the drift of my purpose shall extend no further. Go release them, Ariel. My charms I'll break, their senses I'll restore, and they shall be themselves. Fetch them, my Ariel. You elves of hills, brooks, standing lakes and groves, and ye that on the sands with fruitless foot do chase the ebbing Neptune and do fly him when he comes back. You demi-puppets that by moonshine do the green sour ringlets make, whereof the ewe not bites, and you whose pastime is to make midnight mushrooms that rejoice to hear the solemn curfew by whose aid, weak masters though ye be, I have bedimmed the noontide sun. Call forth the mutinous wind, and twixt the green sea and the azure vault, set roaring war to the dread rattling thunder. Have I given fire and writ of Jove's stout oak with his own bolt, the strong base promontory? Have I made shaken by the spurs, plucked up the pine and cedar graves, and my command have waked their sleepers oaked and led them forth by my so potent art? But this rough magic I hear abjure, and when I have required some heavenly music, which even now I do, to work mine end upon their senses that this airy charm is for, I'll break my staff, bury it in certain fathoms in the earth, and deeper than did ever plummet sound, I'll drown my book.
If you no longer want it, Prospero, give it to me.
What's that? Cigarettes.
The spirits of the island thought they had killed me when Caliban was born, and it appeared they had succeeded for a time.
You have power enough to imprison Ariel in a tree. Yet thou dost say the magic of the spirits is stronger.
They used their inferior magic against me all at the same instant, so its impact was greater. After Caliban's birth, my magic was weaker than theirs. They sought to kill me, but all they accomplished was to put me into a deep sleep.
If thy magic was weak, how then did you awake?
It is a strange thing, magic. When I was forced into sleep, I had only my own. Since I have awoken, I feel I draw from another source. There is another source of magic on this island. It appears, then disappears. When it appears, it replenishes me. I have been trying to find it.
Spirits?
Those pathetic creatures know. It's here. Your books and your staff.
No! I will not relinquish those.
I'll move the lock out!
Only the spirits
We'll have magic now. A solemn air, and the best comforter to an unsettled fancy, cure thy brains. Now, useless, boiled within thy skull, there stand. For you are spell-scarred.
Oh, holy Gonzalo, honorable man, mine eyes even sociable to the show of thine fall fellowly drops.
The charm dissolves apace, and as the morning steals upon the night, melting the darkness so their rising senses begin to chase the ignorant fumes that mantle their clearer reason. Good Gonzalo, my true preserver and a loyal sir to him you followest, I will pay thy graces home both in word and deed. Most cruelly didst thou, Alonzo, use me and my daughter. Thy brother was a further in the act waning. Thou art pinched for it now, Sebastian.
Flesh and blood. You, brother mine, who entertained ambition, expelled remorse and nature, whom was Sebastian, whose inward pinches therefore are most strong, would here have killed your king? I do forgive thee. Unnatural though thou art, her understanding begins to swell. And as the approaching tide will shortly fill the reasonable shore that now lies foul and muddy, not one of them would yet look on me, nor would know me. Go, my Ariel, fetch my ducal cloak from my house. I will discase me and myself present as I was sometimes Milan. Quickly, spirits, thou shalt ere long be free. I shall miss thee, my dainty Ariel. Yet thou shalt have freedom. So, to the king's ship. Invisible as thou art, there shalt thou find the mariners asleep, the boatswain being awake, and force him to this place. Presently, I prithee.
For amidst trouble, wonder, and amazement inhabit here, some heavenly power guide us from this fearful country.
King Alonso, behold Prospero, the wronged Duke of Milan, as assurance that a living prince now doth speak to thee. I embrace thee, and to thee and thy company I bid a hearty welcome.
Whether thou beast he, or some enchantment on my mind to abuse me as lately I've seen, I know not. The pulse beats his flesh and blood, and since I saw thee, the affliction on my mind amends. This must be a most strange story. Thy dukedom I resign, and do entreat thou pardon me my wrongs, but how should Prospero be living and be here?
First, noble friend, let me embrace thine age, whose honor cannot be measured nor confined.
Whether the spear be not on that sword.
You do yet taste some subtleties of the isle that will not let you believe things certain. Welcome, my friends, all. But you, my brace of lords, were I so minded, I could justify you traitors to his highness. But at this time, I will tell no tales.
When I saw my brother Antonio, my hated brother, standing helpless and confused, my mind and heart were filled with turmoil. Long had I hated him for the evil deed he visited upon me, but now looking into his eyes, I felt only pity and a tiny spark of love. I wanted to punish him, but could not find the will to do so. So I gave in to my turmoil and experienced all of its emotions quietly. As it abated, waves of a warmer sentiment began to wash over me, and I was able to speak almost kindly to my captive brother.
For you, most wicked sir, whom to call brother would infect my mouth.
I do forgive thy rakest fault. All of them. And require my dukedom of thee, which I know perforce thou must restore.
If thou beest Prospero, give us the particulars of thy preservation. Tell how thou camest to meet us here, who were wrecked on this shore only 3 hours since, where I have lost a sharp point of remembrances. My dear son, Ferdinand.
I am well fought, sir.
Irreparable is the loss. Patience says there's no cure in it.
I rather think you have not sought our help. Of whose soft grace I, for the like loss, have her sovereign aid, and rest myself content.
You the like loss?
As great to me, and as recent. To make the loss supportable, I have means much weaker than you to comfort me. I have lost my daughter.
Heavens. A daughter. That they were both living in Naples, king and queen there. I myself wish I were muddied in that oozy bed where my son now lies. When did you lose your daughter?
In this last tempest. I perceive these lords, at this encounter, lose their use of reason and scarce believe their eyes. Know for certain that I am Prospero, a very duke, who was thrust forth from Milan and strangely landed upon this shore where you erect hand became Lord Honest. But no more of this. 'Tis not a chronicle befitting this first meeting. Welcome, sir. This cell's my court. Here are thy few attendants and subjects none. Please you, look in. Since you have rewarded me my dukedom again, I will give ye as good a thing to content ye as me my dukedom.
Sweet lord, you play me false.
My dearest love, I would not for the world.
Yes, for a score of kingdoms you should wrangle. And I would call it fair play.
If this prove a vision of the island, one son must I twice lose.
A wondrous miracle.
Those seas threaten. They are merciful. I have cursed them without cause.
Receive all the blessings of a glad father. Arise and tell how thou camest here.
Oh, wonder. How many goodly creatures are there here? Oh, how beauteous mankind is. Brave new world that has such people in it.
'Tis new to thee.
Who is this maid with whom thou wast at play? You cannot be more than 3 hours acquainted. The goddess that hath separated us and thus brought us back together.
Sir, she's mortal, but by a mortal providence, she's mine. I chose her when I could not ask my father for advice, nor thought I had one. She is the daughter of this famous Duke of Milan, of whom so often I have heard renown, but never saw before, of whom I have received a second life. This lady makes him a second father to me.
I am hers. But how oddly it will sound that I must ask my child forgiveness.
Let us not burden our remembrances with the sorrow that's gone.
Look down, you god, and drop a blessed crown upon this couple, for surely it is you that have chalked the way which brought us hither.
I say amen, Gonzalo.
Was Milan thrust from Milan, that his issue should become king of Naples. Oh, rejoice beyond the common joy. In one voyage did Claribel a husband find at Tunis. Ferdinand, her brother, found himself a wife where he himself was lost. Prospero, his dukedom found on this poor isle. And all of us find ourselves where no man was his own.
Give me your hands. Let anyone who does not wish you joy feel only pain and sorrow.
Be it so! Amen!
Is the ship all laid out? Is the bosun ready? My tricksy spirits, thou shalt ere long be free. Good news, my friends! Your ship, which you left split in the water, is now tight again, and as bravely rigged as when it was first put out to sea.
This is as strange a maze as e'er men trod. There's more in this business than nature ever conducted.
Sir, do not infest your minds with the strangeness of this business. Shortly, and at picked leisure, I'll resolve you of every happened accident. Till then, be cheerful and think of each thing well. Go, spirits. Set Caliban and his companions free. Untie the spell. How fares, my gracious sir? There are yet missing of your company some few odd lads, which you remember not.
Every man's shift for all the rest, and let no man take care of himself, for all is but fortune.
Courage, my fine monster, Caragio.
Beatrice Spies, which I wear in my head. I am the goodly side.
Oh, Setibus! These be brave spirits indeed! Oh, how fine my master is!
Oh, I'm afraid I will be chastised.
What things are these, my lord Antonio? Will money buy them?
Very like. One is a plain fish, and no doubt...
Mark with the badges of these men, my lords, then say if they be true. This misshapen knave, his mother was a witch. Once so powerful she could control the moon, whose powers made the waters ebb and flow, in those same waters dead. Now she lies. These three men have robbed me, and with this demi-devil have thought it to take my life. Two of these men, you must know and known. This thing of darkness, I acknowledge mine.
I shall be tortured to death.
Is this not Stefano, my drunken butler?
He's drunk now. Where had he wine?
And Trinculo is reeling ripe. Where did they find this grand liquor that hath gilded them? How camest thou in this pickle?
I've been in such a pickle since I've seen you.
Why, how now, Stefano?
Oh, touch me not, for I'm not Stefano, but a trap.
You'd be king of the Isle, Sirrah.
I should have been a sore one then.
This is as strange a thing as e'er I looked on.
He is as disproportionate in his manners as in his shape. Go, Sirrah, to myself. Take with you your companions. If you desire my pardon, tidy it handsomely and make it ready for company.
Aye, that I will! I would be wise hereafter and seek for grace. What the thrice double ass was I? Take a drunkard for a god, to worship such a dull fool!
Go to, away.
Hence, and bestow the luggage where you found it. Or stole it, rather.
Sir, I invite your highness and your train to my poor cell, where for this one night you shall take your rest, part of which I'll waste with such discourse as to the story of my life and all the happened accidents gone by since I came to this isle. In the morn, I'll bring you to your ship and so to Naples, where I hope to see the nuptial of these, our dear beloved, solemnized. Thence shall I retire me to my Milan, where every third thought shall be my grave.
I long to hear the strange story of your life. It must take the ear strangely.
I'll deliver all. I promise you calm seas, auspicious gales, and expeditious sail. My Ariel, that is thy last charge. Then to the elements be free, and fare thou well. Please you, draw near and follow me.
Thank you.
my charms are all o'erthrown. And what strength I have's mine own, which is most faint. Now 'tis true, I must be here confined by you, or sent to Naples, let me not. Since I have my dukedom got, and pardon the deceiver, dwell in this bare island by your spell, but release me from my bands with the help of your good hands. Gentle breath of yours my sails must fill, or else my project fails, which was to please. Now I want spirits to enforce, art to enchant, and my ending is despair, unless I be relieved by prayer, which pierces so that it assaults mercy itself and frees all faults. As you from crimes would pardon be, let your indulgence set me free.
Oh, Prospero.
I had taken you for dead.
I cling to life, Prospero.
You have the look of death about you.
To whom do you speak? 'Tis most touching.
I speak to the good and patient listeners.
Why do you ask them to release you?
I want to be free of the island. Leave it to its spirits and sounds, and go back to my Milan to end my days.
Why not leave on the ship and forget the island?
I could sail away from the island, but I do not have the power to forget it. The island must be removed from my mind, and only these kind listeners possess the power to do so.
You stole the island from Caliban.
The island never belonged to Caliban. Never belonged to you, and it never belonged to me. I deluded myself for a while that I was its master. It belongs to the spirits that were here at its creation.
My magic is not yet spent, Prospero. With the last of it, I curse you.
There is nothing of Prospero left to curse.
The listeners may remove the island from your mind, but I will put it back. I die knowing you must take the island with you wherever you go. You will never be free of it.
I returned to Milan, hoping the spell cast over me by Sycorax would have no power here, but each day I awoke thinking of the island. I went to sleep thinking of the island. It was always on my mind like an unwanted guest. Eventually, I grew accustomed to its presence, but I prayed every day for release. I told myself that in the end I was here in Milan, and the island was very far away, and it could do me no real harm. But it continued to haunt my memories. Then one day, I noticed that my craving for release from the island was not as strong as it had been the previous day. It was as if somehow I were slowly becoming accustomed to the presence of the unwanted guest. Eventually, finally came the time when I no longer cared about the island. My thoughts of the island lessened with each passing day, and I was free. And finally, they just disappeared. With my mind light and easy, I spent my days reading books about geography and astronomy, science, nature, and on occasion, books about magic. I just happened to be looking for one. But I never again touched a book of magic. I no longer needed books of spells. I'm not sure I ever did. Magic, dear listeners, the mind.